Damn it. back now. I was like, I'm gonna go over the fucking rail and try and go up that way. Anyway, but it's not going up the other way. Ridiculous level. Rev. But you got teeth, you got feather it, you can't just keep it on. Ooh, I got a fist. Oh, that was right then. Nice. Fair enough.
Oh no, I killed Mr. Fun Time. Everyone's trying to kill me now. No. Oh no, it's another fucking fun time. No, stay away. I have a giant cat chasing me. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to shoot you in the face.
Right, so I'm going to do a race I've never done before. It's got two uphills on it. Shit, man. Do something. I'm gonna need fucking get a lot of good luck.
Thank you.
1:35, that's got to be done in Ben. You will.
Wait, is it... What was it called? Overpass. It's a full driving game.
Yeah, it is. It is, and it's well worth the money as well. Yeah, and that was not looking good, was it, before? Yes, I get to repair my vehicle. Well, this looks like it's going to be a fun one. Oh, I've got two viewers. Is that you, Richie Bollocks?
Oh, yeah.
Hiya, Chi!
Oh, yeah, majorly. I can tell it's like a few like 20 seconds out, like 40 seconds.
I know, that's what I'm like. This one looks like it's gonna be fun.
You just said right now I get to repair my vehicle.
Yeah, it is a little bit.
Yeah, I'm just stressing. This is funny.
Am I going that side? I get really confused sometimes with where I'm going.
But no, that game does look good.
Oh, it is. It is really good lag, this game. Well, not... It's like you... It is all about skill, work, and I... Like, some vehicles you think, oh, I can never do that track on this vehicle. And then... Two minutes Find it. I know where to go up now. Restart. I have found how to do it. So how much do I need to make up? You're getting 2 minutes each plus 50 shared between three, so that's 2 minutes 10, 2 minutes 15. What? 2 minutes 10, plus then you've got 21 seconds, so that would be, yeah. So two minutes 16 I need to do it on, right. I think it's going to have to be, I don't think I'll get gold because I don't think I've got the speed yet with this vehicle, but I will try and get as close to it each time so I get the next lot of time. Don't you dare tip this time. She does that, what a fucking asshole. Oh yeah, this game is not about speed, by the way, actually. It is far from it. It is actually all about position.
Yes, I'm not speed.
You lose time by being a speed freak, basically. Yeah, that's what I said, it's like nothing like GTA. Gonna get it.
Yeah.
Cool.
Paid in purchase.
It doesn't take long to download. It's 16 gigs altogether. I think. Yeah, if I remember rightly. So when you first start playing, yeah, obviously try and get it for like the first few goals. But actually, what you need to do is finish a world tour. Then keep going back, and then you'll get the parts, and then some of them will seem impossible, trust me. And they are impossible to start off with, because you haven't got the parts. Because I tried to do a whole gold start off with, and then I quickly realised that I'm being everywhere. Off of the fucking gold. 0.24 of a second. Oh, you know, right? Oh, no, it's fine. It's fine. I'm just glad that I got that done. I'll go back and get that gold on my next time round. I know I can do it. Let's just restart. Gonna be a bugger.
It's shiny.
Thank you. Do you want wee wees? Is that what you want? Do you want the wee wees? Do you want wee wees? Come on then. Wee wees. Go on. Go wee wees then. Wee wees. Wee wees, come on.
Oh, not a flamethrower one. Oh, just fucking two of them.
Wee wees?
No.
Wee wees, come on. Wee wees. No, you don't want one. Come on then. Because you're being naughty. You asked to go out, but you don't actually want to go out.
I almost died. Yay, any crib. Thank you.
Say that again. Cool. Oh, that one that I was on about. Yeah.
Oh, this is why I love this game. Let's bring a chainsaw to a bloody wrestling ring.
think it's alright, I know.
Oh my god, that's how you... Okay. I just noticed, you know how you get your games platinum. Just because in this game there's multiple choice, choices. Like, how you can choose a different way to go.
Oh, okay.
So, like, he can reveal his mask or take, like, he will give you something. And I just revealed his mask. And, yeah, I was... gave me act, like, complete act 3 in one way, and the other one's complete act 3 another way.
Yeah. Cool.
Which is choose the other way.
Cool, cool. What was that, Chris?
Oh, smart car. I want to go drift that. Thank you.
Rusty. Bit of Rusty. Right, let's go back to the game. I don't know if I'm ever going to get up this hill, I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
done a restart because I need 108. Restart that. Downloaded yet, Itch?
Not yet.
Still fine.
got 6 hours.
change this channel over. Thanks. Cheers. Put the news on.
Data from hospitals show that those new admissions to hospitals in England has fallen to 436. This is down from 471 on the 24th of May, so just over a week ago, and down from a high of 3,121 on the 2nd of April. This figure of 436 admissions to hospitals in England with COVID-19 is ventilated beds that are occupied by patients with coronavirus.
Shot up in Scotland, look.
Next slide, please. Thank you.
We're still going up.
Yesterday,
can you see the line slightly going up?
7,607 are now in hospital with coronavirus, and that is falling broadly falling in each part of the country, but for a little bit of day-to-day movement in some of the areas. For instance, as you can see right at the end of the chart, for the northeast and Yorkshire, but we keep that very closely under review. But the overriding trend, as you can see, is down. The next slide is the number of
death shot up then.
Again, the trend is broadly down, but there is still some way to go. After the weekend effect, which we've seen each weekend, in terms of the number of deaths recorded, according to the data that we've recorded, we've seen that rise on most Mondays. And sadly, the figure is 324 today. Next slide, final slide, please. The final slide reports on data from the Office for National Statistics, which was reported this morning, and reported a total of 48,106 deaths in the UK, where COVID-19 was mentioned on the death certificate. And you can see that this number is falling. The top chart shows those data, and shows where we were on the recorded daily deaths data, for the period that corresponded to these data coming from the ONS. On the bottom chart, we can see the place of occurrence of those deaths, and you can see that both the number of deaths and the proportion of deaths that are in care homes, both of those are falling. 27.3%.
Alrighty, have a good night's sleep. Good night.
May 22nd.
See you later.
We don't capture in these charts, but we do capture in a report published by Public Health England today, further data, some of which are much more troubling. The PHE investigation into the way in which the virus targets people unequally and disproportionately has been put on the website. And this is a particularly timely publication, because right across the world, people are angry about racial injustice, and I get that. Black lives matter. And I want to say this to everyone who works in the NHS and in social care. I value the contribution that you make, everybody equally. And I want to say it right across society too. I want to thank you, and I want you to know that our whole country cares about your well-being. And I value too those who come to our country work in the NHS and in social care. And I love that this country is one of the most welcoming and tolerant and diverse. That goes for the whole country, and it goes especially for the health and care system. As I said in the House of Commons earlier, PHE's investigation found that age is the biggest risk factor for coronavirus. Next, gender. Living in a city is a risk. And being black or from a minority ethnic background is also a significant risk factor. There is much more work to do to understand what's driving these disparities and how the different risk factors interact. And we are absolutely determined to get to the bottom of this and find ways of closing that gap. And I'm
Yeah, they did say that they'd be showing it on the world news.
We value the contribution from everyone to fighting this virus. Everyone has a contribution to make. And, of course, the thing that every single person can do is to make their personal contribution to fighting this virus. In the first instance, things as simple as washing your hands, following the social distancing rules, and, of course, if you have symptoms, please self-isolate immediately and get tested to protect your friends and family. So let's keep going, and we'll get through this. We'll now turn to questions. The first questions are from members of the public, and the first one is from Danny from Huddersfield. Danny.
Over the last week, a number of measures have been relaxed. If the error rate now begins to increase because of this, how will you identify which measures need to be reintroduced to bring it back under control?
Well, that is a really important question. I'll ask John to come in a second. The package of measures that we've taken, we judge to be safe. But of course, it depends on how people behave. And so it's important that people follow the social distancing guidelines, even as they're changed. And we'll keep it under review. We then, if we need to make changes, we can either make them at a national level or a local level, and that will be determined by where we see any outbreaks, if we see them. And then at a national level, we can look right across the board. And of course, we've been clear from the start that if we need to, we will bring in further measures. But we've chosen these measures in order to be able to relax some of the most stringent parts of the lockdown, whilst also keeping people safe. John.
Yes, thank you, Secretary of State. I think the answer, Danny, is that it will depend on how the virus is coming back. Key to any public health control, and particularly for this virus, is the surveillance information that we have, including special surveys, but also routine surveillance, for example, from general practice. So if it was if the virus came back in a particular setting, whether it was a healthcare setting or perhaps in a prison or whatever, then you can undertake a lot of testing and infection control in that setting. If it comes back more widely in particular groups, then there would be different measures that could be taken. So it would be in response to the way in which the epidemiology, the counts of the numbers of cases were increasing. It seems likely, from the experience of other countries, that if we do get recrudescence, which is the technical term of the virus, it would be patchy. It would be in localized areas, and that's why we are keeping that under very close control. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Danny. The next question is a written question from Barbara from Bridport. And Barbara asks, when will those members of the general public who suspect that they may have had COVID-19 be able to have an antibody test, and how will this be rolled out? Well, this is another great question, Barbara. And the answer is that in the first instance, the antibody tests are being used by those in the health and social care sector. We are delivering around 40,000 a day across the NHS and social care, and just over 40,000 a day on the latest figures. And then we'll roll them out across the country. We haven't yet been able to pin down the science of whether having antibody means that you are at lower risk of getting the infection again, and critically, at lower risk of transmitting the virus. We've got tests in the field to find that out. So we will be rolling out antibody tests more broadly, and we've bought a huge number of them to be able to do that. They involve a phlebotomist being able to take blood so that you can analyze that blood, which means that we've got to roll them out at the pace that we are, and we're trying to expand the rate at which we roll them out, because I entirely understand your yearning to know. Thanks very much. Questions from the media. If we go to Rhianna Croxford from the BBC. Rhianna.
Thank you, Secretary of State. Many people from black and minority ethnic backgrounds will be confused why it has taken 6 weeks for the government to simply confirm what studies have already shown, that they're dying with COVID-19 at significantly higher rates. Deaths from all causes in this period have been up to 4 times higher on average for people from these backgrounds, and this hasn't been fully explained by today's review. Firstly, how can you explain this disparity, which hasn't just been caused by the virus? And why haven't you done more to protect and support these communities? And if I could also see that response from Professor Newton. And secondly, on behalf of his colleagues, you've been criticised by the Stats Watchdog for the presentation of the virus testing figures. Isn't that embarrassing over such an important policy area?
Thanks very much. I will, if I just address the second question first, and then I will, both John and I, I'm sure, will answer on the first, which is so important. On the second question, the way that we present the stats is the best that we can in the, having built the testing program so rapidly over such a short period of time, we are working with the stats authorities to be able to present these statistics in a way that they're happy with, and to make sure that we're as transparent as possible. I spoke to Sir David Norgrove today, who is the head of UK Statistics Authority, and we'll be working with them to make sure that the statistics are constantly improved. But the way that we present this is the simplest way of presenting a very complex picture of the overall five different pillars of testing, and that's the approach that we've taken. On the first part of your question about the report from Public Health England, I think this is an incredibly important area. I've been really struck by the clear difference in the proportion of people who are dying with COVID-19 from ethnic minority backgrounds, and I wanted to get to the bottom of it. So I asked Public Health England to do this work by the end of May. They've done that. But you're absolutely right that there's much more work that needs to be done, and this report shows that. So I've asked the Equality Minister, Kemi Badenoch, to take this forward and to look into the causes and what further can be done. And Professor Newton's been involved in this work from the start.
So thank you. And just on the reporting of the statistics, it's worth bearing in mind the objective of the testing programme was to build a capacity of tests to respond to the pandemic. And it's really what we do with the tests rather than the numbers which matter. So at the moment we have a falling number of infections, and what we're really keen to do is to have really high quality testing that's delivered quickly and very available. So actually just the numbers of tests isn't a measure of how effective the program is. It's whether we're testing the right people, testing them quickly and getting the results back. So we're happy to report the numbers in any way that we're asked to. The review is an important piece of work. There was a great deal in it, a lot of different factors looked at. Normally a report like this would take us a good 6 months. So we've actually produced the sort of analysis that in a relatively short time. As you say, some of these data were already available, so the Office of National Statistics and other research studies have already published. So we've confirmed that. And it's important to have confirmation from a number of sources. As you say, we weren't able to look at all the potential explanations, but in particular, you mentioned the all-cause mortality being 4 times higher, or actually 3.9 times higher in black men, for example, than in normal times. And it's raised by 1.7 times in white men and 2.9 in Asian men. So there are a number of statistics in there. It's quite a long report, and there's a great deal of background information and detailed information that we think will be helpful. What we'd really like to do now is to get a lot of discussion about all these elements, in particular with all the people involved and the various groups involved in responding to it. So we think the report will be helpful. Some of it was available before, but there's quite a lot of new information there. And it's not easy to go directly from the analysis to making recommendations, and we need to get the report widely disseminated and widely discussed before, I think, deciding exactly what needs to be done. But clearly there are some fairly obvious conclusions that can be drawn even from the data that we have.
Can I please
go off on
that?
Yes, of course, yeah.
Just say, firstly, thank you for acknowledging that Lives Matter in your opening speech, but a lot of people already going back to work, scared that they're not being protected. And there'll be no measures announced today, as we had expected, perhaps be put in place to protect them. Can you say anything to these communities? And if not, can you give us a time frame or a deadline when they will get recommendations about how they can protect themselves going forward, considering that this risk won't be going away?
Yes, absolutely. The number one thing I'd say is that for anybody in a higher risk group, the most important thing to do is stringently to follow the social distancing guide, including the work on social distancing at work that's been published. So there is specific guidance for social distancing in the workplace. So for all of the different high-risk categories that the data demonstrate, it's really important that people follow those social distancing guidelines very stringently. You know, we've been very clear about this from the start, about those who either have a medical condition, and as the PHE report says, age is the number one risk factor, because around 90% of deaths are amongst the over 65. So the answer, direct answer to the question, is the same as to everybody, but with more emphasis, which is that the social distancing is the best way to keep yourself safe and keep others safe, alongside the hygiene and washing your hands and making sure that if you have symptoms, get a test. And I totally understand the concerns that people have, and I understand the anger that people feel about racial injustice more broadly, and I share it, and we want to tackle it. I fully acknowledge that, and it is very, very important that we address that, as I'm trying to do within the NHS and social care that I'm responsible for, and I think we need to do across society as a whole. Thanks very much, Rhiannon. Is that okay?
Yes.
Emily Morgan from ITD.
Hi, if I can pick up on something that Rhiannon said, you launched this review, Secretary of State, this review published today with a huge fanfare to look at how COVID-19 was affecting ethnic minorities. One of the objectives to the review was to make recommendations. Where are those recommendations, and will you be publishing anytime soon?
Well, absolutely, we need to go through the next stage of work to make sure that we take into account all of the different considerations. For instance, the PHE report sets out that it doesn't take into account comorbidities, different occupations, because different people in different occupations have different risk factors, and of course other health factors like obesity. We've got to make sure all of those are taken into account and scientifically, rigorously understand the causes behind the data that are clearly shown today, and take that and take a lesson.
Well, yes, thank you. I mean, I think the recommendations are, there are recommendations there, but they're more to do with the fact that these are important data to be aware of, because as Secretary of State has said, I think even understanding the levels of risk associated with different factors is itself important in designing programs to protect people. And in fact, the NHS has already started the process of risk assessment to start using these sorts of data. So there are recommendations there, but there are still some questions. What we do show is that there's no simple, there's a lot more than just the ethnic differences in the report. There are differences to do with the deprivation and where people live and occupation and so on. And all these causes are the causes of health inequalities anyway. And actually what the report emphasizes is the fact that what COVID-19 has done is to emphasize the existing health inequalities in the country. And it shows us again that we need to address those inequalities, whether they're to do with deprivation or to do with people's background. So in fact, to some extent, the recommendations that have been made before about similar issues still apply. What we have put forward is some data that can be used. Secretary State mentioned the Minister and the Waste Disparities Unit, who have already looked at the data. And I think we will be seeing some recommendations coming out. But it is important that those recommendations are widely discussed with a lot of other groups, not just from Public Health England. But we think the data are going to be important for those processes.
Thanks.
Yes,
of course.
You mentioned risk assessments, and obviously risk assessments are now happening for ethnic minority members of staff in healthcare.
Yeah, I'm just waiting for mine to cool down.
We know that ethnic minorities are being disproportionately affected by COVID-19. Shouldn't all ethnic minorities now be put in an at-risk category to protect them?
Well,
if I may suggest, the key point of the study is it shows although clearly outcomes are worse for people in black and minority ethnic groups, that is not necessarily because of their ethnicity. Exactly as you say, it may be related to their occupation or to other reasons why there might be a higher level of exposure. So one just has to be a little bit careful in doing that risk assessment. One has to look at the causes of increased risk, which may be as much to do with other factors, not necessarily someone's background per se, although there is probably an element of that as well. So the report, if nothing else, emphasizes the complexity of what we're seeing. So really we're urging people not to jump to conclusions and institute measures which are not really justified by the data. So there's an element of caution in our results, as well as obviously pointing out the importance of policy.
Thanks, Emily. Next question is from Ben Kentish at LBC. Ben.
Thank you, Secretary of State. Good afternoon. I wanted to ask you about the ONS figures this morning. 2 months or so ago, at the start of the lockdown, the government was predicting a death toll of between 7,000 and 20,000. The ONS this morning revealing that the total excess mortality since the end of March is three times that, and more than three times that, at about 62,000. I wondered if you had any sense of why you thought that was, and therefore what lessons we could learn about that for the future. And if I could just one for Professor Newton. Testing capacity has increased significantly, but still about a third of it each day is going unused. Just wondered how you plan to use that spare capacity, and whether it could be used for people who have been told to isolate by the track and trace test and trace system without symptoms to decide whether or not they do indeed have the virus. Thank you.
Thanks very much. On the first question, I'll take the first question and then ask Professor Newton to answer the second. On the first question, we didn't make a prediction of the impact of this disease, other than right at the start when there were scientific predictions made, which have been published, showing that unmitigated, with no measures, the death toll would have been around 500,000. And that led to a whole series of changes, including the social distancing and effectively the lockdown, because that was unacceptably high. And we are completely and fully transparent about the impact of the disease. And I welcome the ONS's vigilance in measuring it. The good news from the ONS stats this morning are that the number of cases, the number of deaths, sorry, is coming down. Also the fact that the proportion of deaths in care homes is coming down. Given that that's been a very big focus of attention. Professor Newton.
Thank you very much. So it's a very good question about what are the priorities for the testing programme. So there are three priorities. The first is to support the Test and Trace programme. And the Secretary of State has said we are really keen for anybody with symptoms that might be coronavirus to come forward, have a test, and so that we can give a definitive answer. And if they are positive, they could be entered into the Test and Trace programme. And I should say, actually, we were asked yesterday about some of the statistics, but there are thousands of people already who tested positive, who've been successfully fed into the Test and Trace programme, and they have, using the online tool and identifying contacts, and there are thousands of contacts who've been successfully identified and agreed to self-isolate. So that programme is going well. We don't, in fact, recommend testing for people who don't have symptoms, because if you don't have symptoms, it is unlikely to be positive, and even if somebody who's incubating the virus, the test may well be negative. So if you have a test if you're a contact and during your 14 days of self-isolation, if you have a test and it's negative, you still have to complete the 14 days of isolation. So there is little utility in offering tests to people who are contacts, unless they develop symptoms during 14 days. The second priority is to support the NHS in infection control and other settings like care homes. So we're doing a lot of testing of staff to make sure that it's safe for people to be in a care setting or in the NHS. So that's a substantial requirement. The numbers of positive tests, and particularly asymptomatic positive tests in those settings, are coming down. So we are learning from those results to design those are the three priorities for testing. We are using a good proportion of the testing. Of course, then there are the antibody tests, which are being rolled out first in health and care staff.
Thank you. Because there were forecasts published by members of SAGE, Neil Ferguson's example, and he said today that the UK had been much more heavily affected by the virus than expected. So I just wonder if there was any analysis going on, and if you could share any of that about why that might be, and how we could avoid, if there was a second peak or a future epidemic, how we could avoid those things.
Well, it's undoubtedly true that we had a very significant impact on this virus. There's no doubt about that. And we've been learning all the way through it how best to deal with that. In fact, the test and trace system that we've built over the past few weeks and has been up and running for the past 5 days is one of the lessons that comes out of it. The absolute vital importance of having a system that is big enough to be able to trace as many of those tested positive as possible. And this, in fact, ties in with an additional answer I was going to give to your second question, which is that Professor Newton gave the long answer, if you like. The short answer to the question of the gap between tests done and capacity is that we have spare capacity. This is a good thing, but I would urge LBC listeners and everybody else in the country to use the capacity if they need it. If you need a test, you can get one straightforwardly, go on the website, and you are not only protecting yourself, but you're also helping us to trace the virus and control it, and therefore keep the country safe. Thanks very much, Ben. George Parker from the FT. George.
Thank you. It's a question about the government's plan for a blanket quarantine, a 14-day quarantine of people arriving overseas. Question first of all to Professor Newson. What is the scientific rationale for having a quarantine against people coming in, for example, in a country like Greece, which has very low levels of coronavirus? And would you support the idea of an air bridge between countries with lower infection rates in Britain into the UK? My question to you, Secretary of State, you said on May the 12th that people wouldn't be taking overseas holidays this year. Is that still your advice?
Well,
do you want to go first?
Well, I should say, by the way, that I'm not a member of SAGE, and it would be SAGE's advice is the basis for this. But the principles are clear that obviously we, just like in this country, if somebody might be at risk of having the virus, we need them to be isolated during any period when they might be infectious. And if people are coming into the country, then they really have to be treated as an unknown, and therefore there's a quarantine. Now, if well, there are two reasons why we might not do that. That would be if the risk of them having the virus when they come to our country is so low that we would just take the chance, that the chances of them becoming infectious are very low. And I think at the moment the judgment is that it's too early to say that, and therefore it's better to be cautious for people travelling. And secondly, if we are able to very quickly respond with a test and trace programme, then we could cover it in that way. So if travellers are able to be tested and self-isolate in response to contact tracing, just like a domestic new case, then that would also be a way of dealing with it. At the moment, I think caution is one of the day, and SAGE's advice is that quarantine is appropriate. But as I say, it's not my direct responsibility, but I'm sure those are the principles on which the advice has been given.
Thanks, George. On the specifics, I was actually asked this, late last week, and I said I was more optimistic than previously, but clearly the number one priority is keeping the public safe, and that is the overriding principle, and it has been throughout this.
What, Benjamin?
Yes, of course. Sorry, I thought you would come back.
I love you too. Did you love your Ben and Jerry's or not?
Interested in the idea of an air bridge with you?
Well, this air bridge idea has been floated, and I know there's been a lot of discussion about it, and I know that some countries have been mentioned in the media, but that is a piece of work that's being done
Say that again. Yeah.
Thanks, George. The next question is from Sarah O'Brady from the Daily Express. Sarah.
Hello there. My question is for you, Secretary of State. The spotlight has shone on the pressures faced by our social care system through this coronavirus pandemic never before. And I would like to know, please, so I can come through to the Daily Express, what are your plans and what is your time frame for the long promised radical reform of social care?
Well, I'm glad to say, Sarah, that we absolutely need to make those reforms to social care that have been, in my view, pushed to the side for too long.
Yeah, probably.
In the manifesto, it was only back in December, and we have been working on that piece of work even during the coronavirus crisis. It's incredibly important to me that we put social care on a sustainable footing. And I think one of the positive things, amid the terrible things that have happened during this crisis, is that people have recognised social care as just how important it is. And I think everybody who works in social care has seen that the whole country value them. We need to follow that up with reforms to the way that social care is supported to make sure that more people get that dignity in their older age and the people working in insurance so get the support that they need. So I'm determined to push forward the social care reforms that I know so many readers of the Daily Express are in.
Can you give me an example, please, of one of those reforms? Or give us an idea of the time frame?
Well, the time frame has been clear, which is that we've got to get these reforms done in this Parliament, and the Prime Minister has previously said that we'd get them set out this year. That was before coronavirus. We'll still try to do that, but it is not straightforward. What I can say is that the crisis itself has demonstrated many of the reforms that are needed, like closer working and collaboration between health and social care, like the increased financial support which we'd already committed to for social care, and then we put more in during the crisis, and making sure that some of the injustices in social care are taken away, especially about how it's paid for. Thanks very much. The final question is from Vic McKinney from The Voice. Vic.
Secretary of State, many thanks. I'd like to ask two questions, if I may, and a question also to Mr. Newton. Given the disproportionate way in which COVID-19 has affected people from Black, Asian, and minority ethnic communities, there's understandably a lot of concern, a lot of anticipation about this report, public health in the report, and what it might say. However, the disappointing lack of recommendations is certainly going to affect many. Already we've had a number of emails from readers and reports citing this as another example of government indifference to the kind of inequality that you mentioned earlier on in your address. How will the government address and reassure members of those communities that this isn't just another inequality? The second question I'd like to ask, as you know, the statistics show a clear link between the people working in public frontline communities, frontline jobs, and also the chances of contracting COVID-19. Many people from these communities are in frontline jobs such as healthcare, transport, social care, but local authorities around the country have been very quick to protect being informed through things like risk assessments. How will the government follow their lead? Well, thanks very much, Vic. And in a way, the second question answers the first, in that we've already taken action because it's been clear right from the start. You know, I remember that the first four deaths of doctors were all people from Black and Asian minority ethnic backgrounds. I think three or four had come to the UK to serve in the NHS,
Yeah. How annoying. Chris, your phone's ringing.
I'm going to Now, in response to the publication of a report today which confirms that people of black, Asian and minority ethnic communities have been hit harder by the coronavirus, Matt Hancock said that Black Lives Matter. He also said that the report was particularly timely, given that people across the world are angry about racial injustice following the death in the United States of George Floyd. And he praised the role played by ethnic minority medical and care workers in the National Health Service. Now, following criticism of the government's testing data by the UK Statistics Authority, Mr. Hancock said he is looking at ways in which the information might be improved, insisting the data is the simplest way.
I am just on the other side of the parking lot.
And on the topic of a possible second wave of infections, Professor John Newton, England's testing coordinator, said he is likely to be patchy and in local areas.
Let's get her.
Well, let's just walk through some of that with our health correspondent. And one of the other things
I'm having trouble connecting to the internet. Take a look at the health section in your
Alexa. Thank you for picking me up.
I scored 436. And Mr. Hancock said that was the lowest mark.
I got some cool pants, there's some Kobe, tank top, and magnetic flashes. I wanted to try them out.
There's no greater feeling in the world than to kiss the love of your life.
I love you.
The people with this then expanding hugely, ratcheted up, then we're getting
the collapse at home is completely unresponsive. The vitals are normal, but we're worried about the rash. There's something worse.
Well, I don't want to say she was hysterical, but I'll say it. She was hysterical.
My phone!
Just breathe, just breathe.
I was staring at him.
Oh, I'm sure it's not your fault.
He didn't tell me where he was.
Just let me have a look at him. Can you get Mrs. Maria a copy of this? I need to have a look at him. The paramedics are going up. I'm going to go. Are you guys putting on protective gear? Be terrible. Right. As we predicted.
LAPs have approved the government's motion to only allow the intubation person and not
the remotely. He just was out of it, completely out of it.
One,
down there too. That's nasty. When you see a patient who's in a coma, you want to find out, is there something going on that's causing them to be unconscious that I can reverse? So I started a head-to-toe exam. Vitals looked fine. I looked in his pupils, they looked in his mouth, gag reflex is intact, and really, except that he wasn't responding when he had the rash, it was normal.
Oh, oh my God!
Sorry, Dr. Clem.
Doctor, what's wrong?
Maria, it's okay. We're taking care of him, but you do need to step out. Let's go.
Raul, you rat!
Oh, God.
We've got a patient with a rash all over his body. He's unconscious. I don't know why. And I've got a woman screaming in the waiting room. Increased heart rate, all the pieces to come together, and it was not happening for me. Let's do a sternal rub. A sternal rub is where you take your fist and you actually rub it on the patient's breastbone, on their sternum, and it's uncomfortable. And usually, patients whose brains are connected to their bodies, they'll respond to that. And he did. He had a grimace, which told me that his brain was connected to his body, and that part was working. His pupils are equal round reactive to light. His reflexes are normal. His gag reflex is intact. His vital signs are okay.
Did he have a seizure?
The nurses and I actually talked together in the room. I let them hear my thinking on my plans to evaluate the patient. Partly because it's still a mystery. Sometimes the nurses actually help me solve mysteries.
Or maybe
Todd's paralysis variant. Do you want to do a drug screen?
Sorry, Dr. Clem. I need your help. She wants to know what's going on, and I can't console her, and she's upsetting the other patients.
Joni, let's get that head CT pronto. And Dean, if you would, do a medline for me and see if there's a Todd's paralysis variant that's the whole body.
Why are you wearing gloves and a mask?
It's just standard procedure. I really didn't have time to deal with the wife. I wanted to spend my time working, trying to figure out what's wrong with her husband. The good news is his vitals look good, his reflexes are fine. We're checking him out.
I shouldn't have been so hard on him. I can't stand. The knowing is what's killing me right now, so I have to find out one way or another.
Kayla Shocker again. Charge it up. 200.
Charging.
Dr. Bill West's patient. Beatings of the heart.
Able to put their head together with mine so that we can think. But I happen to know that the neurologist was in-house. I gave him a heads up that I was going to have a consult for him, even though I didn't have the CAT scan back yet. I'd like you to weigh in. I've done a complete physical exam, and other than he's unconscious, there's nothing. Now, the CAT scan's been done. The results should be back any time, but need your help.
Let's see what we got. What is this?
We don't know yet.
Kathleen, you need to gown up.
The neurologist really got after me for not gowning up. He noticed that the nurses were all gowned up. He was worried about this rash to see if it was something communicable. Kind of made me feel a little bit silly that I hadn't gowned up. How is he? The neurologist is with him now.
Kathleen, have you ever had someone cheat on you?
Well, not that I know of, but
that's what I can't stand. The not knowing is what's killing me right now. So I have to find out one way or another. I have to see him.
Dean?
Yeah, I just...
Dean?
Yeah.
Let's grab a coffee. Good.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Just do the hand drop.
One of the tests that was performed is called a hand drop. And that's where the neurologist took the patient's hand, held it over the patient's face, and then let go. Now, a normal person, if you drop your hand over your face, you're not going to let it hit you in the face, but an unconscious patient would.
Goal's eyes. Also interesting. Nice water. I don't think this is a coma.
Just a recap of the coronavirus daily briefing at Downing Street. We heard that the death toll from the coronavirus...
And I don't think this is a rash. Everybody was still around. The neurologist was there. The nurses were there. And at that point, we were all angry. I can't believe it. There are patients waiting with chest pain, injuries, all kinds of things. It's a hot summer night. There's all kinds of people who need to be seen, and he was seen first, because an unconscious patient coming in by ambulance gets seen before other people.
You know how much you've embarrassed me today?
And so he trumped the whole crowd and got seen first, and for no reason.
How do you feel you're being out to stay for yourself?
I know.
I can't believe you.
I get it, Maria. Sorry.
Excuse what?
What?
Folks. There's going to be some financial consequences to what happened here. He took my time, he took the paramedic's time, he took the nurse's time, he took the neurologist's time in the middle of the night, all of those lab tests, everything, for no reason, just because they couldn't decide on their marital spat how to end it other than to pull us all in.
Forget it. He's a cheater.
Sometimes people get the wrong specialist. They didn't need an ER doctor. They didn't need...
Okay. Here, take the tea bag. Take the tea bag. Okay? What I need you to do? Yep. Cut off the top of it so there's no string. Cut right through the top so it's flat on the top of that tea bag. Go for it. Cut
you
that
mean
top.
Like cut
yep.
The tip right off?
Oh, a little bit down further.
How much?
Further.
Is that there?
A little bit more. Perfect, right there. Cut it off. It should be perfect. Take all the contents of the tea bag, put it in the center of your plate. Okay? Everything, get it into a nice little pile. Cool, now you've got a tube, a little sleeve from that tea bag. Why don't you open up that sleeve?
Okay.
Okay, but set it aside because first we need hydrogen peroxide. Open that up.
Oh my gosh.
A little eyedropper here. Okay, so get all of that tea bag into the center. Into the center. That's a little bit too much. We can probably get rid of some of it, so I'm going to take about half of it. I'm just going to put it over here. Okay, yeah. Get that all together.
Okay.
Beautiful, beautiful. I see it's still a little bit too much. There, get that all together, okay, take the eyedropper,
okay,
get the hydrogen peroxide, just get a couple drops of hydrogen peroxide. Yeah, you got it.
How much?
Just a couple little eye drops.
Right on top of it?
Yeah, drop it. I'll tell you when to stop. One, two, three. Perfect. Excellent. Okay. You can put the rest back. We don't need the rest of it. Yeah. That stuff. Yeah. I better take that. I'll put it over here. Okay. Last thing. This tube.
set that tube up so that all of that tea with that little hydrogen peroxide is in the center.
Like?
Yeah, yeah. Perfect. Make sure it stands up on its own.
Okay.
Okay? Now, we got some matches and a straw.
Thousands of our small businesses are keeping the nation.
Oh.
Individually brilliant. Stronger.
Distraction.
On either side, both sides of the tube, and you gotta be quick.
Right here.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Both sides actually do. Don't do it where there's a crease. Do it on either side. Okay.
Yeah. It's flat.
Yep. Where it's flat. And you gotta be quick. Okay. Because you're gonna do it. So go for it. Light up that match.
You're gonna do the straw.
You're gonna see. You're gonna pick up that straw in a second. Okay.
Are you making me suck fire?
No. You're gonna be great. You're gonna be great. Okay. Okay, perfect. Wait, and, yeah, okay, light. Perfect, there you go, now you got it. Now light both sides quickly. So, one and then the other. Go. Oh, quick. Okay, now watch it. That's it, that side. There you go. Now watch, grab the straw. Okay, watch this.
What?
As it floats in the air, wait for it, it's going to come back down. You want to catch it in your hand. Yes, you're going
to
catch it in your hand. Hang on, right over. Get ready.
Okay.
Right there. Take the straw. Ready? Suck it up.
What?
Yeah, suck that right there.
No!
Yes,
ew.
Yes. Right there.
That can't be right. What
did they do? Yeah, it's not right. I don't know why you did that. I don't know why you listened to me.
After the death last week of George Floyd in police custody, Donald Trump said if cities and states failed to control the civil unrest sweeping across America, he would bring in the army to solve the problem for him. The Democrat presidential candidate, Joe Biden, has attacked the president's handling of the protest, which began in Minneapolis last week, saying the U.S. was crying out for leadership. With no violence last night in Washington, where the president walked to a church near the White House and held the Bible for a photo opportunity. A North American correspondent, Lisa Gould, reports from Washington.
Come on, Mama. You
can
do this.
He told Biden in the shadow of the White House in memory of
the Oh, he's crying.
Donald Trump decided he was going to dispatch
him. As we speak, I am dispatching thousands and thousands of heavily armed soldiers, military personnel, and law enforcement officers to stop the rioting, looting, vandalism, assault, and the rotting destruction of property.
Oh, okay.
This demonstration was gas and shot and put back for the historic.
Don't need it, but I want it.
With a short walk to St. John's Church down in the
Push
White
him up.
House
video. Push him up.
With a Bible.
Yeah, they're all right.
Oh, God, come on, little bud.
Save him.
But the security forces continue to force back demonstrators.
Yeah. Oh my God, come on, save the bloody baby. Come on. Lila, you just licked my ankle, you weirdo.
Oh God,
You know, what are you doing? You're being a bit weird.
Well, I don't know if the babies will be able to get over. It was Mama. Oh, there's one more little baby. Hey, get over, little baby. Oh, it's a tiny little baby. Yeah, he's looking for his Mama. Oh, here comes Mama.
Are you ninnins? You want me chicken? Oh, nothing. What did you say, Nins? I will do in a minute. Let me go away. For fuck's sake. Alright. Oh. Good girl. You a good girl. I could hear you, Nins, but obviously I had you mute because I was waiting. I'm sure you didn't want to. I am, I'm coming down the stairs now. Coming down the stairs. Oh, that looks nice, Nins. Is that like rice needles? Okay, yeah. Looks nice, Nins. Looks lovely. Yeah, next time you're over, you know what you're making. Yeah, you know what I get from mine. I can get pretty much everything. Can I? Yeah, but I would have, if not being funny, if you was over, I wouldn't be fucking on my diet.